express his regret for missing this moment. We welcome you here on behalf of the family. As they turn, they look and they see the sea of faces. What an awesome showing of love and relationship for Miss Alice. And so if you could just continue to encourage the family and love on the family, not only today or tomorrow, but for days and days to come. I just would encourage you to show your love and tell stories and special memories that you have and you share. You're gonna get a chance a little bit to do it today, but it means so much in the days coming ahead just to hear that phone call, have that phone call, and have someone share a story of how Alice touched your life. So I encourage you to do that today, if you could. Let's go ahead and pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, that there is a moment in time where this transition that has happened for Alice, she knew one reality, she was upon this earth, but when she breathed her final breath, there was no lag of time, there was no waiting. Lord, she was immediately in your presence. And so, Father, we're so thankful for that. We know where Miss Alice is at. Lord, and we come into this place to celebrate the life that she lived. And boy, did she live life. Lord, we thank you for your hand upon her life. We can see Jesus through Alice. So Lord, as we gather today to remember and to thank you for this life that was shared, Father, we ask and we pray that we would be drawn closer to you through this process. We understand and we know that death is not an end. It is just a beginning to an eternity, a lifetime and beyond what we can even imagine or think. It's an eternity that we have to spend with you, hopefully with you. So, Father, I pray that you would be with us today and that everything that we say and everything that we do would bring glory to you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. At this time, Scott, come on up, and he's going to read the obituary.
On behalf of my family, thank you everyone for being here.
And a microphone might help. Alice Louise Roach, age 89, lifetime LaPierre area resident, died December 6, 2024. She was born August 20th, 1935, in Flint, Michigan, to Samuel and Bessie Thompson Ingram. Alice graduated in 1953 from Millington High School. She owned and operated Alice's Wallpaper and Painting for over 35 years. Alice painted and wallpapered for many families in LaPierre, developing many friendships and return customers. She took great pride in her work. Alice was a devout Christian and a longtime member of the LaPierre Assembly of God Church. She also attended First Baptist Church of LaPierre for many, many years. Alice was an excellent softball player, playing well into her 60s, winning many tournaments and senior Olympic medals. Anyone who played with Alice or watched her play softball realized how much she loved the game. She was an avid sports fan, always watching the Detroit Lions, the Detroit Tigers, and many of her grandchildren's sporting events. Alice lost her leg over 10 years ago, but continued to live on her own, driving on her own and mowing her own lawn. She will be missed by everyone who knew her. Alice was survived by her children, Matthew Roach of Seattle, Washington, Sally Bill Schaefer of Davison, Samuel Patricia Roach of Kalamazoo, grandchildren Lynn Henry, Anne Fiancee Kate, Scott Janelle, Matthew Lisa, Douglas Bradley, Jennifer Matt, David, Jessica, John, J.R., Ryan, and Andrea, several great-grandchildren and sister, Nancy Davidson, of Clyde. She was preceded in death by her daughter, Mandy, grandson, Michael, parents, Samuel and Bessie Ingram, and siblings, David Ingram, James Samuel Ingram, Barbara Baxter, and Martha Foster. Thank you.
At this time, Sam, her son, is going to come and minister in a couple of songs.
We picked out a couple of moms I think, were her favorite, but she loved them all. So I'm going to ask you to stand. I'm not going to ask you to stand on just your right leg, but I will ask you to stand. And the music is provided by my wife. We recorded it the other day.
Praising my Savior all the time.
praising our Savior all the day long. I loved watching Alice worship. Longings and loving on Jesus. And so I just truly, truly love that. At this moment, I would like to open up just a brief time for family and friends and family that went to her church with her. They have some stories, some really great memories that just speak to who this woman truly was. I want to invite you up. Again, my job today is to preach the sermon. Yours is just to share a short little memory, okay? So as you come up, share a short little memory, leave room for others, because again, this woman has touched. And
really, I've inherited my grandma's big voice and
stubbornness.
Yes, well, I'll get to that. But if you would all just be quiet for a second, you hear that? Alice just rammed her amigo into the wall. Everything I'm about to say is from the perspective of an undeserving grandson. Son of a gun. Who got to see God take his grandma from ordinary to extraordinary. My grandma was special. In one second, she'd chew your ass up one side and down the other. To the next second, she'd remind you how much she loved you, and so did Jesus. My grandmother was unapologetic, demanded two things, loyalty and genuine love. And she gave it right back to you. You also couldn't escape her life even if you tried. There's three men here today, John Morse, Paul Fisher, and my dad, Pete Hagedon, who, for better or worse, tried. love the three of you. Which leads me to my first story. In the summer of 2018, my grandma decided she was going to clean her garage. The only problem was my mom and my Aunt Mandy were at an event called the Roach Roundup. Scott lives in Grand Rapids. At that time, Doug was living in Lansing. Matt lived in Florida. It was a beautiful Friday afternoon. I'm working up in Midland. I get a frantic call from my grandma. I'm stuck in my garage. He goes, she's what? Doesn't your mom know she needs to tell your grandma to slow down? There was no telling my grandma to slow down. Thank you, Dad, for going to save my grandma that day. My grandma was almost, and I mean almost perfect in my eyes. I say almost because my grandma was beyond stubborn. As most of you have nothing to hang your head on. Your mom loved you and you loved her. And by golly, you should be proud. My grandma also gave you the most important thing. You love your kids with all your heart, mind, and soul. My grandma could make you feel many things. Happy, sad, thankful, and occasionally you'd cringe about something she'd say. But most of all, like I said, she would make you feel loved. And I will miss, beyond measure, doing yard work and fixing her tractors when they broke down. 2 years ago, almost to the day, I took my oath of office. Shortly after the grueling primary, I asked my grandma if she would hold my other grandma's Bible. And this is true. It is the only time in my grandma's final 5 years I cried in front of her. My grandma cried too. And on that cold December day, my grandma held my other grandma's Bible. And for me, that was the icing on the cake of my relationship with my grandmother. I want to end by saying this. My grandmother was a pain in the ass. But she was my pain in the ass. And I miss her more than I can ever describe. And I wouldn't change a damn thing about her. But I know, for fear of her jumping out of that casket and yelling at me, I must finish with this. Friends, if you don't know Jesus, get to know him, for that's what Alice would have wanted. Thank you, and God bless her.
Same lungs, you don't have to use a mic. No, you don't use a mic.
Well, I do want to begin by saying most people that went to church with my grandma knew she fell asleep almost every service. Also, I know my family's nervous that I had the mic. You never know what's going to come out of my mouth, but I got that trait from my grandma.
Good afternoon. My name is Douglas. I had the privilege of being Alice's grandson. I was very close with my grandma, and not only did we share a lot in common, but we had serious discussions about the ending of her life. My grandma made us make her two promises for her funeral, so I'm here to discuss those promises with you that we made with Alice. The first one was that she wanted humor at her funeral. She loved laughter, and she didn't want her funeral to be people solely mourning her loss. So here's my attempt at fulfilling that promise. Grandma, I'd like to thank you for my wife and kids not being able to make it here today. If you don't get the joke, it's fine. I'm 35, I've never been married. But to further explain it to you, the last 10 years, I've spent my weekends trying to teach my grandma how to use her smart TV and her smartphone. And Carol and Jenny can tell you that it is a never-ending task. And I'm sure too many of you had the privilege of seeing my grandma's Facebook Live bathroom incidents. There was multiple of them. I know the panic that went through me any time these would happen. Ironically, my last memory with my grandma is when she got a new TV the weekend before Thanksgiving. Which, by the way, family, dibs. But I spent over an hour trying to show her how to use her new TV, and her showing me back the directions I just showed her. Later that night, around 9:30, Grandma called and asked me once again to explain how to use her TV because she couldn't get the channel to change. I told her the TV wasn't the best fit for her. And she said I just needed to reteach her again sometime. And I argued again, if the TV's not the best fit for you, you're never going to learn how to use that TV. I guess looking back on a technicality, I won that argument. Humor was my grandma's vice to moving forward in life when she lost her leg. I still remember the story of my grandma being on an elevator, the door opening, someone entering, and giving my grandma an interesting look. Without missing a beat, Ellie and I, along with Meathead John and my stepdad Bill, will be her pallbearers. She was a rock for each of us for so long. It's only fitting that we should be honored as the ones carrying her to her final resting place. And just to prove my grandma's love of humor, which she really did say this, and I even did you all a favor. I made sure there was one less leg to carry so the casket would weigh less. It's stories like this as to why I'm certain she requested there to be humor at her funeral, especially with a person like me. The fact my grandma asked me to make people laugh at her funeral shows her sagacity. She knew if I focused on that, it would make me think of the great luckies I am to have with her, and that laughter is truly the best medicine. It got her through the hardest times of her life. And she wanted to make sure it got me through mine. She was one of my best friends, and I'm thankful for every life lesson. And despite being the most handsome, smartest, funniest, most athletic, and certainly the most humble, I always find myself striving for more, to make her even more proud. I thank each and every one of you who came out to pay respects to Alice Louise. She wouldn't want us to mourn her loss, but to remember the good, the charismatic and loving individual she was. And as she would always say, never let a win go to your head or a loss go to your heart. Keep moving forward and trusting God. Thank you.
Since I already came up here, my family asked me to be the short one of the group, so I will be just like them. So I had a speech prepared, and then this morning I went for a run, and I put on an artist I usually put when I go on a run that kind of calms me. And the second song that came on, there's a line in it, and it was repeated over and over again. And I had to call my mom afterwards. I couldn't tell what the line was, but I said, this really stuck with me. And it said, you led me through the deepest waters, but I promise loud to carry you on. And I think everyone in this room knows that at some point in their life, Alice carried you through your deepest waters, and now it's our turn to carry her on through our life. And then as I was finishing my run, the very last song that came on, at the very end there was a line, and again it hit me where it was like my grandma speaking to me. And it says, and I wave up to the crowd,
found to be shocking, because my whole life I thought it meant a stubborn force that does things her way. My grandmother will always be one of one to me and to many. To tell her she couldn't do something meant you were quickly going to be told you were wrong. She loved telling people they were wrong, especially anyone reffing against her grandchildren or her favorite sports team. Rumor has it, the local high school officials were relieved when her youngest grandson was finally gone playing football after years of her yelling at them from the bleachers. Sorry, I'm getting an alert from heaven. Okay, just an update. Alice is 3 for 3 with 2 doubles and just let off a fifth with a triple. My grandmother's a force that didn't allow anyone to stop her from anything. Stop her from loving the Lord with all her being. Stop her from being her grandchildren's biggest fan. Stop her from loving her friends and family with all her heart. And stop her from being a very proud member of the LaPierre community. Or stop her from lending a helping hand to anyone in need. To me, she's grandma, but to the world, she was simply Alice, a noble woman who is now exalted in the presence of God.
Mom was driving down the expressway. She got hot, so she wanted to take her sweatshirt off. She's driving, mind you. So with this hand, she tried to lift it, got caught. It's over her face. She continues driving, and then she thought, oh, maybe I should pull over. That's Mom, independent as can be. Second thing, I would take her to doctor visits, and one doctor visit, they said, how tall are you, Alice? And I said, it depends on which side you measure her. She never forgot that. And you know, she's a big sports person. And she coached many things, but when my oldest was 2 years old, LaPierre Days was having, it was called the Little Caesars Youth Run. It started out with 2 and 3 year olds ran, 4, 5, 6, and 7. But when she found out I was putting my son into that race, for a week, she measured up the distance. Every day, she taught him how, when they say start, run, and run all the way through the end.
Thank you all for being here. I probably have a loud enough voice, but I'm gonna use this anyways. I'm not a public speaker. I'm terrible at this, so bear with me. I've written about 15 pages to read today. However, I'm not going to do that to you all. I'm going to hit some highlights. It's hard to find one thing that's a fit all for Grandma. There were so many stories and so many memories. So before I start mine, I'm going to read a couple of poems. One was written by Uncle Sam. Was not to be. So he put his arms around you and whispered, come with me. With tearful eyes, my eyes are tearful, I can't read. My tearful eyes, we watched you suffer. We saw you fade away. Although we loved you dearly, we could not make you stay. A golden heart stopped beating. Hardworking hands came to rest. God broke our hearts to prove to us he only takes the best. That's beautiful. The second poem that I would like to read, one of the things that she taught me very young was, I think I maybe was 4 or 5 years old, came into Grandma's house and I said, can I have candy? Because I knew where Grandma kept the candy. There was a drawer next to the refrigerator, we knew it was always full. So I walked and said, can I have candy? And she said, all the time. It tickled her and made her laugh hysterically. We lost some closeness, Grandma and I did. Kids, family, they take a lot of your time in a lot of ways. And when I was diagnosed with cancer, the phone calls changed from Grandma. It used to be, how was your day? How are you doing? Have you eaten anything today, Grandma? Have you drank any water today, Grandma? To Lynn, how are you today? Have you talked to God today? Do you know where you're going to go for all eternity? And I have to admit, I had turned away from God. I had felt forsaken. But she brought me back. And our conversations changed to being intimate and reliving stories from her childhood and memories that she has from junior high and high school. And I will never forget all of those conversations and the special moments that we shared. So thank you, Grandma, for everything you've given to this family, this community. We love you now, we love you forever. I'm so glad you're walking in heaven.
I'm a little bit taller than Scott, so I need more cord. Sorry, I lost my voice. First off, I want to thank this church for giving my grandmother a home. Like Lynn, you know, most of my conversations with my grandmother were about faith in God. She loved seeing photos of my family at church and church functions and when they're baptized and always making sure you go to a church that preaches the word of God. I want to thank her for teaching me how to use power tools, not always safely, but how to use power tools. I can do work around my house because of her. On our side of the family, I have a daughter, the only girl on our side, and I made the mistake of naming her Mackenzie Alice. So that was the little creature that is stubborn, just like her great grandmother, that yelled no and threw the book against the wall and had to leave. And again, back to sports, and 2 years old, we would FaceTime my grandmother. And on FaceTime, my grandmother would ask my daughter, who's 2 years old, does she know how to hit a ball? Can she throw a ball? Thank you all for being here. It means a lot to us. She's going to be missed. I'm going to keep the faith. Thank you.
Guess we'll go row by row. Is there anyone else that would like to share? I just wanted to take this time and open it up. If you got something, come on up. Come on up.
She beat you.
I wrote this poem for Alice. The beginning was August 20th, 2018, and finished it up December 8th, 2024. Alice, my good friend, we met in a place of recovery and rest. The name of the place, Lapeer County Sunrest, Suncrest. God brought us together with his word. I read to you my favorite chapter and verse. Our common ground is Jesus Christ. From death and hell, he did arise. Holy Spirit power with which to win. defeating the enemy's every whim. Christian sisters enjoying sweet friendship, God's mighty hand guiding our trip. We follow his spirit at every measure. Thank you, Lord, for this wonderful treasure. Earth's journey is now complete. You ran your race so faithfully. A new heavenly one has begun, walking along with Jesus the Son. Well done, he will say, as you pass by his way. See, I make all things new. These sayings are faithful and true. Your body, brand new it will be. Earth's corruption defeated, heaven's victory. Walking on the streets of gold, Alice, a masterpiece to behold. Though we'll miss you so much, our memories will clutch. You have left us with so many joyous times, they were plenty. We will meet once again, ultimate healing will win. It's not goodbye, my friend. It's I will see you again.
For those that don't know who I am, I'm John Morse. I was married to Mandy for 8 years, I believe it was. Had two beautiful girls, Lynn's here. And I got to know Alice very well. I enjoyed sports, and that's one thing we had in common. I was going to say a whole bunch more, but Bradley, I had to clarify. He said Meathead. For those who don't know who Meathead is, that's Alice's pet name for me. But I also had one for Alice. I called her Maud. So we had Maud and Meathead. And I loved it. And that's what we stayed in touch all these years after the divorce. She loved me and I loved her. She kept me on the straight and narrow, even though it didn't work a lot of times. When you're a police officer for over 37 years, you kind of see the seamy side of things and your judgment gets thrown off to the side and you forget where you're supposed to be. But Alice, I was good news. I loved her. And I know she loved me, and I'm really going to miss her. So thank you very much, Alice. I will forever be your Meathead, and you will forever be my Maud.
Tears yesterday at church, sitting there, the little empty spot right there. When I met Alice, I barely knew her with two legs because she had just started coming, and I met her mostly it was Pastor Vic's office. She had walked here from home, and she had just had I think she had that thoracic surgery. I'm Jenny Burkhart, by the way. I'm her strange friend. Who doesn't like sports? We were such an odd couple, it was a hoot. But I remember, talking with her, and she was talking to Pastor Vic, and he was like, and she walked all the way here from home, and I'm like, can I drive you back home? She's like, no, I need to walk. The doctor told me I need to exercise, and I'm like, I like her. She's real sassy. I was like, yeah, we're gonna be friends. And so we got to know each other just a little bit in ladies' Bible study, and then, she went to the hospital because she was afraid she was going to lose her toe. So obviously that began a lot. I didn't like sports. And she'd be like, why are you friends with an old lady? Like, you're young, why are you friends with me? And I'm like, because I love you. It doesn't matter our age, you know? And so when I met her, I didn't have these yet. And when I turned 50, it was my little birthday present to myself and kind of surprised a few people. And came to church one day and she's looking at me. Remember, she'd squint. She'd give you that. She kind of squinted at me and she didn't really say a whole lot. And so, I don't know, like a couple weeks went by and she kind of comes up to me. She goes, are you black? Are you a black person? Black lady? I was like, oh, loved her. Just loved her. So anyway, and she actually asked me twice. So I remember one of the things, I mean, she'd just shoot right from the hip. She just wasn't, and I remember one time we were at some function and LaDonna Bright had come up and was talking to her and talking to us, and LaDonna walks away and Alice looks at me, she goes, she is so nice. She is just such a sweet person. And I looked at her and I said, am I sweet like that? She goes, no. She goes, you're not. She goes, you're kind of like me. Kind of more saucy than sweet. So, but probably one of my funniest memories of her was when my son got married in August. And I know I've told some of you this, but she had gotten there a little bit late. And we were literally getting ready to walk down the aisle. I had my son like this. And we're walking down, getting ready to walk down the aisle, and Alice had come late. And so she pulls in, and we did not think to put the little empty seat there. So the only place Alice could be was the aisle. So we're all sitting there, we're going, oh my God, we can't walk down the aisle. So I'm sitting there, I'm trying to talk to the young man that married them, and I'm looking, like, trying to, like, can you get her out of the aisle? And finally I had to tell my husband, I'm like, to say something to Alice. So of course, I don't know that Alice had her hearing aids, or the one that didn't really work was in. And so he had to go, Alice, Alice, Alice. And she like looks up at him and he's like, you need to go over here. And so we all had, they had to like move the seats, and then she's like, beep, beep, beep. And the whole time, I'm just sitting there, and I'm crying because my son is just nervous, right? And I'm just sitting here, just waiting, watching all this happen. And I just go, I just love her. And my son's like, oh, do not love her right now. And then we proceeded to walk down the aisle, so we had to wait. But anyway, Alice was very special. And, you know, how many of us all took her out to eat, and some days she could swallow and some days she couldn't. So we'd be having something to eat. She goes, hold on a minute, I gotta go in the bathroom. But it seems like so many people wrote poems. I thought, I'm just gonna write her a little poem. So, but she loved the Lord and I loved her boldness. And I loved that because we both kind of had a Walmart ministry. You know, she'd be talking to people, I'd be talking to people. And sometimes we'd be there for over an hour talking to each other. So I just want to end with this little poem. Mother, sister, wife, and friend, God was with you in the beginning, and he was with you in the end. Even though time towards of late were full of trials, tragedies, laughter, and pain, your passing into eternity was our sorrow, but heaven's gain. Mother, sister, wife, and friend, you tried to tell the world, he is the beginning, and he is the end. Put your trust in Jesus, who is, it can also be, our eternal friend. Amen.
Anyone else like to come and share? Yeah, a couple, so.
Well, I'm probably one of Alice's oldest friends. Not many people have the privilege of having a true friend for 62 years. Alice and I have been friends for 62 years. Having been friends for that many years, we have many memories. We met at a lake around the Hadley area, around a bonfire, We had recently moved to the area and my parents were camping there and invited the Roach family from the church to meet us there. That meeting was the beginning of 62 years of friendship. We enjoyed the fun one can have with eight children together. We camped together at Osmeek on the shores of Lake Huron. As we left camp one day, all loaded in our station wagon, no seat belts in those days, we discovered we were lacking one of the eight. As we hurried back to camp, there was the missing child sitting by Lake Huron, playing with his truck, not even missing us. That was God's protection at work. God's protection at work. We believe in it. It was on this camping trip that Sam's bed was a padded dresser drawer because we didn't have all those fancy things that people have today. But he seemed to sleep well there. The children loved going to the Roach family home where they could stay together and we shared preparations for us and celebrations of graduation. Our kids seemed to just kind of alter every year, so we were always together fixing food and getting ready to celebrate their graduations. And for some of them, we were able to help each other with the weddings that followed. We were blessed to have their family help when we started to build our cottage on Long Lake near Sheboygan, Michigan. We all camped on the property as we worked on the cottage, which included my parents also. There was 10 of us all together. Some fixed meals in the camp kitchen. Children helped carry cement blocks. Some of them brought sand for the mortar. Others were just, you know, doing whatever was asked of them. One of the children had an emergency appendectomy. He was one that always faked not feeling good. And so we didn't pay a lot of attention to his concerns and his pain until one night he was groaning. And I said to my husband, I think this could be serious. Maybe we should go to the hospital. His appendix were ready to burst. So when the children went to the hospital to visit, Alice was sure they all went to the dime store, which we had in those days, to get their favorite candy. Always trying to make it fun for the children. Alice was the coach for the Awana girls at our church for the Awana Olympics. She inspired those girls to do their very best. Most of the time, they came home being successful. Throughout the years, she has kept contact with many of these girls, even though they live out of state, encouraging them in their Christian walk. Not only did she listen to their Bible verses when they were in Awana, but she also earned the Timothy Award herself. Alice has been referred to as a sports fan. I'm not. I don't know how we stayed bound together so tightly when much of her conversation was about sports. She not only loved them, but she participated in them. In her business, she had many people with her, many young people who worked with her. And they learned many useful lessons, which they now use in their own home, repairing, painting, and keeping up their rental properties. No job seemed too difficult for Alice. She always found a way to meet the challenges. Even as she had her amputated leg, she always found a way to meet the challenges. She did the things that seemed impossible for the ordinary person. Many conversations with her about the predicaments she would get into being the independent person that she was. I remember one time she was telling me she was weeding her flower garden. She'd gotten off of her Nego. She was on the ground. She was pulling the weeds. And then all of a sudden, she wasn't sure how she was going to get back up. She pulled on the Mego right on top of her. And the story that she told of how she managed to get out from underneath that. She was even taking care of the leaves on her property not long before she suffered the strokes which took her life. After 62 years as friends, we both endured joy and deep hurts. We always had each other to share our struggles and to bring them to the Lord. It is an unusual friendship to stay solid for so many years, even though for the last 31 years we have been separated by distance. And by the way, I want to take time to thank my son-in-law for driving me down here today. I'm so happy that she attended this church where she felt loved and cared for. Her fellowship in this church met many of her physical and spiritual needs. Her love for the Lord was easily seen in her life, has been testified by all of you. It wasn't unusual for her to start a conversation with strangers in a store and end up giving them the salvation message. She often told me about her devotion time at bedtime. With her Bibles and her songbook by her side, she worshiped the Lord in reading, praying, and singing. She would say, "I'm glad God doesn't care if I don't carry a tune." Alice was a month younger than I. She would call me on my birthday and say, "Hello, you old lady." I will miss those calls, my dear friend. I know you are enjoying your new home in glory. There to worship the Lord.
Sister wasn't able to be here. Her name is Virginia Benton. And I told her if they did this talking thing, I would say what she wanted to say, which was, Alice, she was her coach for Awana Olympics. And Virginia says that she could do anything because of Alice. Because Alice told her she could do anything. And that meant running that circle and grabbing that bag first. And that meant you did it. And Virginia was built a lot like Alice, kind of short in stature and legs. But Alice told her she could do it, and she did it. And that meant that Virginia had to learn verses. And that meant Virginia had to go to First Baptist Church, which in turn meant my family went to First Baptist Church. So her teaching Virginia to run that race and grab that bag brought my family to First Baptist Church, which then instilled God in our lives and our walk with Christ. So I believe that all stems from our little one-legged friend here and that determination and that you can do anything. And that was from my sister, so.
I have two quick things I want to read. This is from Jessica Argue. It says, "When I think of Grandma Alice, I think of a strong, independent, hardworking woman. Even though she wasn't blood, she always treated me as such, and I'll always be grateful for that. I'll always cherish the time and memories we had together." And this is from John Argue. It says, and he's in Tampa, Florida. "I will miss you, Grandma. You showed me the ways of working hard. You were a go-getter and you never stopped. You taught me discipline and that no matter what, to keep going. I'll always remember you picking me up the morning of 9/11 and you took me to Wendy's. Thank you for being my friend and family. Thank you for being at my adoption and birthday parties and Christmas. I love you, Grandma. And I wanted to hug you and thank you for being you and for being a guiding force in my life. Thankfully, I don't have to talk. I can sing. I wrote this song a number of years ago, and Mom told me to sing it, so I'm going to sing it."
Oh, We worship the Lamb now. We bow at His feet. We sing His praises for now and always. We worship the Lamb now. We lift holy hands to praise our Savior and glorify Him. Oh, see the Lamb of God, His Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. He died on that cross to save your soul. Oh, worship the Lamb. Oh, see the Lamb of God, His Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. He died on that cross to save our souls. Oh, worship the Lamb. So serve the Lord now with your whole life. You love us with willing to sacrifice. The love that you showed us, we really must share.
She taught us to do everything, to be very independent and know what to do and how to build a house, whatever. One example, when my husband and I bought our house, I despised the carpet in the living room. I kept asking for a wood floor. After about 2 years, I didn't have a wood floor. So he went to work, I had the day off, and I knew he was going to coach football, so I had plenty of time. I ripped up the carpet, took off the foam, took every little staple out. He came home and went, "Well, Alice, I guess you have your wood floor now, don't you?"
I'm Pastor Vic. I'm glad to
that you're doing this because I wouldn't have made it. She let me call her mom. I remember the crazy lady the first day she ever came here. I was working out back, and here she comes in the door. She's like, "You a pastor?" I'm like, "Yeah." She goes, "You don't look like one." And I was like, "Okay." Anyhow, she wanted to talk about our beliefs, and she goes, "I'm Baptist, and I know you guys aren't." And we talked for about 3 hours about fundamentals. That's why I don't mind making this longer, because Alice was always the last one up, and I always put her, so why not one last time? But she's like, "I just want you to know you're on watch." And I'm like, "Okay, so are you." She said, "Good, we'll leave it that way." But Alice just had a way of everything, and I love sports. My wife doesn't. She was talking to me and my wife one time about sports, and she goes, "What do you think about the Lions this year?" And she goes, "Well, I can only watch for like one or two innings." And Alice is like, "How do you stay married to her?" And Alice just had this way of being independent and just learning about shit. She let me call her mom because my mom passed, and she was a great conversationalist. I mean, she could talk to anybody about any subject, anytime, anywhere, and that's why she was so good at introducing people to Christ. And I said, "Can I call you, mom?" She's like, "Yeah." And it took me a couple of years after she had her leg amputated to get her to allow me to help her in the van. She's like, "Why do you want to help me?" I was like, "Because I love you." She said, "Okay, as long as it's not because you feel sorry for me." And she would always say, "Well, you come up and take me out." But she was just a special lady. I was up seeing her right after she had her stroke, and she couldn't really talk. All she kept doing was saying please, and she was moaning in pain, and I just prayed, and she grabbed my hand and squeezed so hard, but she stopped moaning in pain the whole time I prayed. She just had tears flowing. She was an amazing woman. Family, I feel for you. I just had to make it last a little longer one last time.
Well, to be honest with you, this is just so fitting for Alice anyway, because she had her own timetable. She didn't really care about anybody else's. So if you were thinking that you were coming in here and you were going to get in and out in an hour, Alice has not a chance. Okay? And just so you know, you think, well, maybe the preacher will be quiet. He'll be shorter. He won't take as long. That's not right. Okay? Because, again, I think Alice would be upset with me if I didn't deliver a message. I believe that she stood on both legs for, and that's Jesus Christ. And so as I thought about this dear woman and the many, many years that I've known her and had opportunities to talk with her and go over to her house and sit with her, help her, all of those different things, she has made an everlasting impact on my heart. And I believe on each of yours in a very special way at this church. So many stories. I mean, volumes, encyclopedias of stories that we could come up with Alice. She was perfect fodder. If something could go, Alice would find it and make it happen. So we could spend tons and tons of time to do that, to reflect on that. But I'm going to limit mine for just a couple of them that meant something to me. And I, like Pastor Vic, she would come up to me every Sunday or Wednesday, and she'd ask about the game and talk about the stats and the players and what they did and their accomplishments and the grandkids. And she'd throw those sport facts in there and all those different things. And she asked me, "So did you see it? Did you enjoy it?" And I'm like, "Honestly, Alice, I have to be honest. I have a house full of girls, and sports isn't really on the top of our watching list." And she goes, "Well, you need to leave them at home and come over to my house and we'll watch them together." And I'm like, "You know what? I'm going to take you up on that." And so as I was over, there were times the game's on, we're sitting there, we're talking back and forth, I'm holding a puppy, we're screaming at each other over the TV volume, okay, because there's no
quiet conversations with Alice. She had one volume, and that was just loud. And so we would converse, and we would have a great time talking. There was also a time where it was one day after a service. I think it was potentially a Wednesday service that she had came to. My day off was on Thursday, and so I was here on Friday, and I was going down this back hallway, and I looked out the door, and Alice has a spot. Everyone knows this spot right here in the back is Alice's. Don't park there. She'll boot your car all the way. She'll sideswipe it, whatever. So that's her spot, and if it's not a spot, she'll make again her spot, and it's that one that's real close. And so I seen something laying on the ground, and I'm like, oh no, what do I want? Sure enough, I walk out there, and I grab it, it's a wallet, and I'm like, I know this has got to be Alice's. And so I open it up, and there's her stuff, and she got a wad of money. And so I'm like, I call, Alice, are you missing something? And she's like, Pastor, I have been praying for days. I can't figure out where I left my wallet. It's got to be around here somewhere. And I'm like, well, I have it in my hand. She goes, I'm coming. I said, I can bring it to you. No, I'm coming. I got stuff to buy. And so there she comes. She rip snorted through the parking lot up the. I'm like, here you go, Alice. She goes, okay, good. She goes, is all the money there? And I'm like, yes. I didn't take any. Whatever was in it is what's in it. And she goes, okay. Well, I gotta go spend it now. And I'm like, all right. And so the fact is, she goes, I've just been praying, asking God, where is it? And you called. Isn't it great how God works? And I'm like, absolutely, it is great. It is great how God works. God knows, God sees. He's involved. He's not a far-off God that doesn't care. He cares. Alice has definitely left an impression, not only on myself, but every single one of us that is here today. I can't go through the many years of her at this church and not see her at almost every activity. Family camp. Wednesday night service, immersed service. I mean, we can go on and on. Fellowship groups. She was present. Whenever the doors were open and she could physically make it here, she was on her way. And didn't matter. It could be raining. It could be sleeting. It could be snowing. It could be a horrible time. Day, weather, she would persevere. She would come. One of the other stories that we actually have a picture in our office. One time she went over to our West Campus and she forgot her amigo. And so we actually have a picture where Pastor Vic and a couple of the other guys grabbed a chair for Alice, put it on this little low cart, and she loved it. She was like the queen. And so she had this entourage of men pulling her on a cart, on a chair, into church, you know, and there's palm branches being waved. Everyone's just, whoa, Alice! And she just loved it. She ate it up. And so we have a picture, and that's always a picture that I hold in my mind. But Alice, she was just present. She was present. She was here. And she was involved in each and every life that she did. I don't know anybody that she wouldn't talk to. Didn't matter if she knew you, she's going to get to know you. If you were a little kid, I remember watching. She'd come in and I'd have her maybe teaching a Bible story in the kids' class, and she's like, I got suckers. I got candy. I got stuff that I'm going to give these kids. And I'm like, well, you got to be careful, because some parents, I don't care. I'm like, who's going to argue with that? Go ahead and give them what you want. Sugar them up and send them home. That's fine. That was what she did. So I remember her coming and hugging and loving and waiting to see these little kids come in. And she would just drive her little amigo right over there, scare them half to death, give them, grab them up, hug them, love on them, give them something, and just tell them how special they were. That's what kind of lady she was. In the past couple of months, we've had two at our church. At our West Campus, we had one, and at our East Campus here, we've had one. Two wonderfully strong, godly women go home to be with Jesus. At our West Campus, Judy Vail, longest time member of our church, went to be with the Lord, and she was a strong woman. Her strength was quiet. She was a prayer warrior. She would go after
breaking of heaven. She had such a strength, and as she passed and she transitioned, she left all of that to her family and to those that knew her. And then I look at Alice here, and right there, that's I was preaching on Sunday, that's Alice's spot. And I'm like, oh, I do miss the beep, beep, beep. I do miss, what did he say? I'm gonna miss that. I remember just a couple weeks ago, Pastor Dan and I were talking. She got stuck in that back. She's like, I can't get through, you know? And so she's trying to get out. And Pastor Dan's like, yeah, I'm just gonna keep preaching, you know? And I'm gonna miss that. But Alice had a strength, and I joke, y'all call it stubbornness. I think it was determination. I'm sure she had a little bit of a stubborn streak to her, but nonetheless, I'm going to try and paint it a little bit different. It's determination, and she just did not have the word quit in her vocabulary, or can't in her vocabulary. She was physically strong, and she only had one leg at the end. I would look at her, and I'm like, girl, how are you still going? How are you doing? She would tell the stories where she locked her keys in the car. She's huffing herself up through a window into the car to try. The things that she did were amazing. She's out there, and I would get many phone calls. Pastor Donnie, can you come over? I'm like, yeah, what's wrong? Well, I ran over a rock, and I can't get the tractor off of it. Yep, I'm coming, Alice. She goes, I can try and push it. I said, no, stand. That's all that I need you, Alice, is on the ground trying to push a tractor off of a rock. She called me up, I don't know what's going on, but I think there's a stick in my lawnmower. I'm like, yeah, hold on then. So these were the kind of conversations. She's like, oh, my door on my fridge fell off. And I'm like, Alice? Okay, so we started off with little 10 millimeter screws to keep the pin and the door on. We got duct tape on the door. I had to transition from eighth inch to a quarter inch to 3/16 leg bolt. To keep, I said, Alice, you've got to learn to drive. She goes, I do know how to drive. I'm a good driver. And I'm like, Alice, no, you're not. I said, we've seen you drive. We pray for you when you drive. We pray for others when you drive. I told her, I said, I'm going to get you a metal cone that's going to protect the corner of your refrigerator. That way you'll damage your Amigo and not your fridge. And so Pastor Brennan and I, one day, went over there, and she goes, oh, I got another fridge down in the basement. It's an easy, easy fix. I'll just bring it up here. And I'm like, I'm looking at Pastor Brennan, ain't nothing easy. Ain't nothing easy. And so we had to detach things. We had to hunt through a house to figure out how to turn off the ice maker and the water. And then you name it, we're doing it. And we're taking everything on. We finally got that fridge up there, and praise God, the pin was on the other side. And so I said, well, now, Alice, at least if you hit the door, it's just going to say, take some food out. Close the door back up. It's not going to damage the door in any way, shape, or form. But she was physically strong. She was a strong woman. All the chores and all the maneuvering. And again, you know, she would fight with you. Now, I can put the card in my car myself. And I'm like, I know you can, but you don't need to. And again, it was that the aspect of love. Let us love you. You love everybody else. Let us love you. Run up to the van and help her in. She was strong not only physically, but she was a strong spiritual presence. And if you haven't heard that ring out true through all the many testimonies this morning, she knew who her Savior was. She loved Jesus. She had a strong spiritual presence. She talked about Christ all the time to anyone who would listen. She was a strong personality in our church. And I love that about her. She had all her hats and all her bling and all of those things that she just loved. And she was unapologetic. This is me. And here I am. Love all of me. And so she had such a great personality to our church family, full of life. As I said, she loved to worship. She loved talking, fellowshipping. Again, she'd be one of the ones that would close us out. She'd be one of the last people here because she's talking with everybody. She always carried a special joy around with her. I couldn't believe it. I'm such a wimp. If I experienced half the things that dear lady did, I feel like I would be such a wimp. I'm like, I can't do
was such a testimony. Her testimony was it meant so much to me because of all of the hardships, trials, tragedies, circumstances that have happened. And she kept joy in the midst of it all. She knew that her hope and her salvation was Jesus Christ. And God knew exactly what was going on with her. He seen her. She knew that he seen her. And that she was very precious to him. She didn't complain. Well, don't get me wrong. She had times of sadness, as we all go through those moments. But those times of sadness did not keep her. Because it always turned back to, but Jesus knows. And one day I'm going to see him. One day I'm going to talk with Jesus. One day I'm going to walk with Jesus. She was a precious woman. I cannot wait to see her in heaven again. I have lots of people that are in heaven right now that I'm waiting to see. Alice is going to be one of them. I just think that many of you knew her with two good legs. We knew her with one not so good legs and then one not so good leg. But I'm guaranteeing when she's in heaven and she's running and she's doing, I was listening to Sam, he's like, yeah, she's probably in right field right now. She's already kicked somebody out of the way, said, no, this is my place, my position, and they're going to town kind of thing. I'm sure that happened, but just after she spent some time with Christ, because that was her focus point, amen? So when I began to think about Alice and all of the many things, two words came to mind. No excuses. No excuses. When I looked at this woman and I looked at her pursuit of Christ, and all the many things that she had experienced through this life, good, bad, and ugly. And to watch her countenance, and to see her faith, and to watch her live with joy, I thought there's no room for an excuse. You and I, we have no excuses. Not a one. She didn't offer any excuses. I believe Alice would tell us today life is short. And we should not waste time making excuses today, living fully as she did in her relationship with Jesus Christ, loving others deeply, serving and giving others. I never once heard Alice make any excuses to justify not doing something or not being somewhere or going to help somebody else out or loving or serving. I never heard her make an excuse. If we're honest with ourselves, she could have. There was a lady that should have got a pass to complain and to use some excuses. I think that would have been Alice. But never once on my watch, never once did I ever hear her complain or use an excuse. And she experienced some tragic things. Loss of a leg, loss of a daughter, so many other losses, so many battles, so many victories. What a remarkable woman. What a remarkable woman. I can see her here. I can hear her say right now, all right, get on with it. Enough about me. Get to the point. It's Jesus. It's the time that I had with Alice. It was always Jesus. Jesus was the reason for anything and everything that she did. She would constantly remind me, Psalms 90, verse 12, she would tell me, this is what you got to teach those young people, talking about the youth that we taught. Teach them to number their days. Psalms 90, verse 12 says, teach us to number our days that we may gain a heart of wisdom. We need to make the most of every single moment. And death, this moment, is a good catalyst to remind us to live life to its full. I believe just like Alice did. You and I, we make excuses from time to time. I've used this one, I'm too busy. Anybody else out there? You ever too busy? I'm the only one, okay. Thanks, Sam. Okay, yeah, see, I'm used to people saying, yep, me too. Okay, so I'm tired, okay? All you wives, go ahead, raise your hand. I'm tired, right? Okay. I don't feel good.
But there's tons of excuses, right? We can come up with a myriad of excuses. And when I was thinking about no excuses, a passage of scripture was reminded to me in Luke chapter 14, verse 16 to 21. And this is what it says. Jesus replied, "A certain man was preparing a great banquet and invited many guests. At the time of the banquet, he sent his servant to tell those who had been invited, 'Come, for everything is now ready.' But they all alike began to make excuses. The first said, 'I have bought a field and I must go and see it. Please excuse me.' Another said, 'I have just bought 5 yoke of oxen and I'm on my way to try them out. Please excuse me.' Still another one said, 'I just got married, so I can't come.' The servant came back and reported to his master. The owner of the house became angry." Now, just so you know, the things that they had to do weren't bad. They weren't like sinful things. They were good things. But they had been invited into a banquet, just as you've been invited into a relationship with Jesus Christ. Alice made no excuses. She knew who her Savior was. She found herself saying, "I choose Jesus." At any and every circumstance, she chose Jesus. And so this morning, we need to be like Alice. We need to be like King David, where he had excuses. He could have offered excuses. He went to battle with Goliath, the huge giant, and he didn't have the proper armor to go face such a giant. He could have made tons of excuses, but he didn't. He said, "I will follow and believe God." And he defeated the giant. Esther, a beautiful queen, saved an entire race of people from annihilation because she wasn't afraid to go before the king. She could have offered up a ton of excuses, but she didn't. And I look at Alice in the same light. Alice could have offered up a ton of excuses. "I can't go to church. I only have one leg. I can't go to church. I'm tired. I don't have the energy. I don't have 2 good working hearing aids." That didn't stop her. She knew where she needed to be. As we reflect on her life, I want to encourage you to pause, think, and identify the areas in your life that maybe you've been making some excuses, especially when it comes to your relationship with Jesus Christ. Ephesians chapter 5, verse 5 through 15 through 16 says this: "Be very careful then how you live, not as unwise, but as wise, making the most of every opportunity, because the days are evil." Alice would tell you right now to stop procrastinating. Stop making excuses. Choose Christ today. Live for Jesus Christ today. Tomorrow's not promised. We often put off till tomorrow what we should be doing today. You might be saying, "But Pastor, I'm good enough on my own. I'm a good person." But people die and go to hell every day. There's one way to get to heaven, and that's through Jesus Christ. Maybe you're saying, "Pastor, but you don't understand. I've done so many bad things. He doesn't want nothing to do with me. I'm damaged goods." And to that I'm going to say, no, you're wrong. That's a lie. Jesus loves you. He sees you. He knows every single thing that you've said, thought, and done. As heinous as you might think they are, he says, "I love you in spite of. I love you just the way that you are. But if you come into relationship with me, I'll redeem you. And I'll change you. And I'll bring salvation to you, which he alone can only offer." The Bible tells us that every single one of us that are sitting in these chairs, we've all sinned. What is sin? Sin is the things that we say, think, and do that are contrary to God's will in his way. All of us have sinned. We're all sinners, every single one of us. There's a penalty for that sin. There's a payment that needs to be paid to pay for sin, and that's death. Jesus Christ offered himself once and for all as our sacrifice to pay for all of the sin. The only perfect man ever to walk the planet paid for all of our sin. And then the Word of God says that if we will confess with our mouth and believe in our hearts that Jesus Christ died, rose again, seated at the right hand of the Father, if we'll confess Him as Lord of our lives, we will be saved. No excuses, no tomorrows, the time is now. I told you when I first started that I thought Alice was probably the strongest person I knew. But I want to clarify, her strength was not her own. She didn't operate in her strength. She operated in the strength of the Lord Jesus Christ. And that is what enabled her to go the distance in which she did, in the way that she did. Her strength came from Jesus. Her strength came through her faith in relationship with her Lord and Savior. And so this moment, right here, right now, I want to challenge each of you to pause and actively pursue, like Alice did, a personal relationship with Christ. Don't let fear or stubbornness or excuses hold you back from experiencing God's love, His forgiveness, and His promise of eternal life. You want to see Alice again? She's in heaven. You want to get there? It's through Jesus Christ. So if you would, we're just going to take a quick moment and just bow your heads and we're going to pray. And if there's some things that you know that God doesn't look on, and he looks on and he's not pleased. Those things are called sin, where you're separated from God and there's some distance and you need to say, you know what, I need to be forgiven for that. I'm sorry, Jesus. That's what it's all about. We're going to gather and we're just going to simply say, Jesus, forgive me from all the things that I've said, thought, and done that are contrary to your word, contrary to your way. I confess you as my Lord and my Savior. Help me to live for you the rest of my days. Today I offer no excuses. I want to know you, Jesus. Will you save my soul? I promise you, he will meet you right where you're at. So let's pray. Heavenly Father, search us, know us. Lord, if there is any place where we're far off from you, Lord, let us stop making excuses. Let us turn to you. Lord, we're all sinners. Please forgive us. Forgive me, Lord, from all my sin, all my shortcomings. I believe that you died on a cross to pay for my sin. You died and you rose again. You're seated at God's right hand. You're making intercession on our behalf. And Lord, we choose, if that's you and you haven't accepted Christ as your Savior, this is the statement, Jesus, I choose you as my Lord and Savior today. Forgive me of my sins. Make me new. Jesus, have your way in this place, in this people. Today, they have no excuse. They have seen the testimony of a godly woman. They have heard the word of God. And today they have had an opportunity to confess you as their Lord and your Savior. So, Father, we pray that you'll continually draw each and every heart here closer to you. In Jesus' name, amen. So, at this time, I'm going to have Colleen, if she's out there. Colleen from here? All right, there you go. Come on up, Colleen. We're going to just kind of shift the service a little bit. You want to go ahead and just give some final thoughts, and then Sam is going to go ahead and close us in a song, okay?
All right, we're going to dismiss. Did you want to walk out with a casket?
Right, I have one song to do.
Though. Right, so I think he's going to do a song, and then we're going to go out.
So let's go do your song, then, Sam.
Well, there's one last song. My mom promised that I would do at her funeral. It is track number 5. Track number 5. If you know it, sing along.
Paul Bears, I'd like you to get two by two in your designated order behind Pastor so we can make our way out to the vestibule. And we're going to have just family follow us out to the hearse. The rest of you are going to head to the luncheon. Or just wait one moment, because they'll be right done. Go ahead, Pastor.
Hold on. Before you leave. Sorry, that was my last prayer. You haven't left the house.
Family comes back in, and let's go ahead and we're just going to say a quick word of prayer over the food. And our encouragement is every single one of you, don't go home yet. Come back and fellowship and have some food and tell some stories and share some memories, okay? Let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you, Lord, for Alice's life, how much she has meant and continues to mean to each and every one of us, Lord. I'm so glad that she has been reunited with her Lord and Savior. Lord, we pray over this food, that you would bless it, that you would bless this family as they mourn. Father, let their hearts be comforted with the fact and the knowledge that she is in your hands right now. So, Father, we pray a blessing over this food and this time. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. So, families going back to the food, go ahead, please do so. Congregate, fellowship, talk, share, eat. God bless.